Good evening, students. Very good evening to all of you. Students, confirm. Once you are there. All of you. Can you just share me the link? Okay, friend. So let's now get started with this one. Good evening, friends. Mishang, Priya. Good evening, friends. Yeah, I was not well. A bit of bad throat and cold herein. So nevertheless, I am in medication. I'm still in medication, but I thought just to maintain, keep the show going on, because it is important that we should be conducting it without any break. At least small topics also we can just wrap it up, even that is important, but the break should not be there. So students, what I will do, at least I will be there for you for an hour or so, maybe 2 hours at a stretch, maybe a bit taxing on me at this stage, but at least 1 hour we will have daily sessions, because as we all know, it is equally important that we stay connected in our particular lectureship, isn't it? So students, right now we are, today would be closing this topic, the biggest topic, which is on PGPP. Again, I'm repeating, students, how you are going to revise this particular part, students. Right, you're all fine. I'm fine in medication. That is what I have said to all of you. Yeah, warm water is recommended. In fact, throat, a bit of a throat infection, and maybe that from this side it has went up to a bit of fever and all kind of a thing has happened. Anyway, that is something. Srivastav, I'm good here. So students, please now pay attention. Now this session number 11, now quickly I will give you a recap here. What we will be looking at right now would be that, first of all, please ensure your revisionary part. What I have told you first, the charging section 28 is only for MCQ purpose. You will read as if you have to do only the MCQ for charging section number 28. Jibin, Trinath, good evening. That is for section number 28. Thereafter, the next particular point, students, would be about the big deduction. Directly go to the depreciation, students. Follow the chart. That first particular chart which I have prepared, that is very critical. Go with that flow. Basis of depreciation, SLM basis, the block method, what is the eligible asset, and what are the rates of depreciation, that also needs to be known. What are the condition, ownership is the condition, and then the put to use, and then the miscellaneous concept, then the concept of the actual cost, students. We have seen some of the important points of the actual cost, how the actual cost has to be determined, and finally the miscellaneous concept, which is about the apportionment of the depreciation. We have seen even the practical problem, students, even the practical problem, we have taken that in that thing into account. So considering all these factors, students, you close this depreciation. My only humble suggestion to all of you would be that that depreciation area is so big, students, that you should just ensure that this, there's no gap. Depreciation 35 and 35 AD, students, depreciation 35 and 35 AD. This three area, since you have done it soon, you just ensure that you are quickly going through it, because these three areas are the only biggest area. Rest of it, as we all know, small deduction 36 and all, it's quite easy from the list that you can easily do it. Then thereafter, there's a general deduction 37(1). Then disallowances. Disallowances also, I have already have taught you how we are supposed to go through it. Charts also, as you have prepared it. So those will not take time. My point is that those will not take your time. But the major time that may get consumed is only the three section, 32, 35 and 35 AD. 32, 35 and 35 AD students. So these three section students, you just go through, ensure to go through it carefully, and that is what is required. Now then, we go to the last segment, equally very important for IPCC, the presumptive area of the income. I think all of you are aware of this section. However, considering a bit of an amendment and certain other areas, this presumptive taxation and the books of accounts, they equally are critical students. Okay, so students, today I will close this particular topic here, it and then from next tomorrow we'll start with capital gains, the next particular topic in our discussion. So let's start with this one. All of you will take this section 44 AD and all. I think all of you would have taken by now. I also forgot to prepare this particular the WhatsApp group herein. So students, here I'll just give you one contact number. Tomorrow, all of you who are there will message them, and accordingly in the WhatsApp group you will be added. So, shall I just straight away give you the number? But message is tomorrow, not today. Okay? And do a WhatsApp message. Okay, so this would be for CA Inter. This would be for CA Inter. 9594554391. So tomorrow you just tell in the through a WhatsApp message, kindly enroll me in the number, but tomorrow, because I have to give the instruction first. Okay, so just do that, friends, and that should be all. Now herein, let's take a cross through this particular section here, the presumptive basis of the taxation and the books of accounts and the audit. They are very important section, students. This thing can come in the examination for sure. So you just a bit be a careful on this particular part. Now coming to the first one, students, this 44 AD, quite popular section. Now first of all, students, here you should be aware of this point, that the SSE 44 AD, students, this is in your slide number 16. 44 AD is in your slide number 16. So in this context, students, first of all you should understand who is the eligible SSE and what is the eligible business on which you will be allowed to take the benefit under this particular section. So the eligible SSE and the business on which you shall be allowed the benefit of this particular section. So let's have a look on this context, presumptive income. So here the eligible SSC students would be in the white shade, students. Just focus presently on the white shade in that particular chart. Eligible SSC means an individual HUF or a partnership firm who is a resident but not a LLP. So partnership has got two categories, one a normal partnership, another is the partnership which is in the LLP form. So LLP is out from the game. You will not be eligible for the benefit of 44 AD, but if it is about the company, then in that case, students, the company will be eligible to claim the benefit. The company will be eligible to claim the benefit of section 44 AD. Sorry, will not be eligible for the purpose of claiming the benefit of 44 AD. So two persons are out from 44 AD, and they are the LLP, partnership LLP, and the company. So they will not be eligible for the purpose of taking up the deduction under this section. Point number two, students, we have seen 10AA. Be very careful, students, be very careful. 10AA is there in your syllabus. Yes, in that 10AA, students, if supposingly I as a person, my turnover, I am a partnership firm and I'm taking a 10 double A deduction. So your MCQ kind of a question can be targeted that whether you, as a person who is taking a 10 double A deduction, having a turnover of less than 2 crores, whether a deduction, whether he can opt for a presumptive basis of determining his PGBP, you will say the answer to be no. In that case, students, you are going to say the answer to be no. So this is one point also that you should be very careful about it, because 10 AA is there in your exam, is there in your syllables. We have already done that. And in dealing with this, we have to say that the provision will not be made applicable. 4480 presumptive income will not be made applicable wherever the SSC has opted for the profit link deduction under section 10 AA. Okay. What about 3580? If he has opted for 3580, like for example, now see very intelligently, 3580 primarily, whether if the SSC has availed 3580 deduction, whether 4480 will it be available? Let me ask you this question. If he has taken the 3580 deduction, whether 4480 will this be available to him quickly? If he has taken the 3580 deduction, then whether the 4480 presumptive benefit provision, will this be available or not? Give the answer for students. Nishank, Pavan, Chandana, Trinad, so students, the answer is in this regard. What is the scheme of 4480, by the way? What is the scheme of 4480? So the scheme of 4480 is that 8% of the turnover or the gross receipt or 6% of the turnover or gross receipt is deemed to be your income under the PGBP. So it is taking the aerial route. Aerial route means directly 8% or 6% of the gross receipt or the turnover is deemed to be the PGBP. So therefore, where is the question of claiming the deduction on the actual basis? You are saying that I want to cut the cake and I want to have it too. You cannot have best of both. That you, anyway, the person who cuts the cake, he does not eat it. Have you seen in your birthday, you're cutting the cake and you're eating it yourself first? No, you never do that. So therefore, you want to take 4480 option. At the same time, you want to also 3580 deduction. How that is possible? When you say that I am taking 4480 option, what does it imply? 8% or 6% of the turnover is deemed to be by PGBP. So where is the question of claiming any deduction at first place? So if you are choosing, yes, Amla, if you are choosing to take the deduction, students, if you are choosing to take the deduction, do you know what you are doing it? You are then opting out of 4480. You are then opting out of 4480. Did you all got this one? So this is how it has to be considered. Be very careful about this particular part as well, students. Point number two. Now, if you see on the right hand side, eligible business means, what does it mean? It means any business except the business of plying, hiring or leasing good carriages referred to in section 44A. And whose total turnover or gross receipt in the previous year does not exceed rupees 2 crores. So, obviously, that why 44AE has been eliminated, business which is of 44AE, because for 44AE, there is a specific provision of presumptive basis of determining the taxation. So, since there is a specific provision, therefore, if your business is that of GTA, you are a GTA, and that GTA is covered in 44AE, then the question of... then the question of determining the income under 4480 will not arise. And all the same time, friends, both the things should be there. And what? The total turnover or the gross receipt should not exceed rupees 2 crores. Rupees 2 crores. Now you tell me one thing, students. The tax audit limit, students, here. 44AB, are you aware of tax audit limit? 1 crore, more than 1 crore, and more than 50 lakhs. In the case of business, it is more than 1 crore and 50 lakhs if it is in the case of a profession. So my question, therefore, to all of you is this, that if my tax audit goes beyond rupees 1 crore, if my tax audit students goes beyond rupees what? Goes beyond rupees, sorry, my turnover goes beyond rupees 1 crore. For example, 1.5 crores. So, question here that can be targeted in the examination is like this. MCQ question, students. This will be MCQ question. Ashutosh, that 5 crores limit is for May 21, November 21 attempt. Okay, 5 crores is for May 21, November 21 attempt. November 20, we still have only 1 crore. So, we'll stick with November 20 attempt for whatever is the amendment. From that perspective, you'll stick with that. So, students, just pay attention on this particular part, which is about this thing. Your turnover is more than rupees 1 crore. Your turnover is more than rupees 1 crore. 1.5 crores, I have told you the exact answer. 1.5 crores. My question is this, that I can opt for 44AD presumptive provision. But question here is, am I liable then for a tax audit as well? My presumptive income is my turnover is 1.5 crores. So I am eligible for 44AD provision. But here what my question to all of you is, am I also then liable for tax audit under section 44AD? Ashutosh, Nishank, Sandeep. Chandana, Pramnath, Sri Savara. Students, let's have a look over here then. Jibin, Pawan Kumar. Students, please have a look to 44AB. This is your yellow chart, the yellow color shade. Now in this case, if you see very carefully, in this context, who is required to get his account audited? Students, you will find from A to E. In your this entire chart, you will find A to E. And each of them are independent to each other. A to E. So just focus on this A to E. First one is carrying on the business, the total sales turnover or gross receipt in business exceed rupees 1 crore in any previous year. That is one. Point number B, carrying on the profession, if the gross receipt in profession exceed rupees 50 lakhs in any of the previous year. So there is a 1 crore threshold for a business and 50 lakhs. So this is what I was talking. But if you see point number C, students, where the SSC is covered under 44AE, forget 44BB and BBB. That is, you will do it in final CA for non-resident taxation. So where the SSC is covered in 44AE, that GTA, and the GTA is claiming that the income is lower than the such deemed profit and gains from business or profession. So if he is claiming that my income is less than the presumptive income of 44AE, then tax audit not applicable. Same case for profession, students, there is section 44ADA. For a profession, there is section 44ADA, and if any specified profession to whom 44ADA is applicable, but he wants to opt out of 44ADA, then you can opt out for the 44ADA. That is to say, you want to show the lower income other than those which is arrived on a presumptive basis under 44ADA. So if you want to show the lower income, please go ahead. We won't feel offended, but you have to maintain the books of accounts and get it audited. And the last but not the least is the person who is carrying the business, which is what we are talking about it. So here is the SSE who was taking 44AD benefit. Now he wants to opt out and he wants to offer a lower income. If he wants to offer a lower income other than that which is determined under 44AD presumptive provision, then that particular person can definitely opt out from the scheme, but he has to get his books of accounts audited. So students, these are only five categories. in which the tax audit is necessary. My question now, coming back to my question, which would be your MCQ question in the exam. The question was what? That here my turnover is 1.5 crores. Okay, so it is going beyond 1 crore. Yes, but be careful, students. But be careful for 44AD category. 44AD category, the tax audit would be applicable only if. Only if what? Only if I offer an income. I want to offer an income which is lower than the 44AD income. So can we put it conversely? Can we put this statement conversely? That if I want to offer the income which is equal to or higher than the 44AD income, which is equal to or higher than 44AD presumptive income, then will I be required to get my books of accounts audited? And the answer is no. So I neither am required to maintain my books nor I am required to get it audited. This is what, students, this point number E, this is what this particular point number E would be all about. Yes, Jibin. So therefore, just keep in mind this particular point, students. This is an important one which you should be very careful about it. Okay, so therefore, this is one thing which I just wanted to do it, because this would be your MCQ question that you can consider this one. Now, one more consequence, students, one more consequence will be there. So I was up till now, students, up till now, I was in 44AD, my turnover, I was the eligible SSE, I was doing, having the eligible business, turnover was also less than 2 crores. So I was only in 44AD. Suddenly this year, because of COVID and all, I realized that even 8% of my turnover in the year of COVID and all, my turnover is hardly 30 lakhs. Okay, but and my actual primary profit, my expenses were the same. We have realized that the expenses remain the same. I have not done any cost cutting. With my turnover coming down and the expenses remaining the same, I realized that I am having not 8% of the profit. My profit is lower than 8%. And that is the reason why I don't want to opt for 44AD this time. Because my expenditure remained the same and my turnover has decreased. So therefore, my profit is not equivalent to, or it is much less than 8% of my turnover. And if that is the case, students, if that is the case, then I want to opt out for 44AD. The law says that fine, you opt out for 44AD, we don't mind. But do one thing then, you have to, not only this year, but for the next 5 years also, not only this year, plus next 5 years. So current year, which you are opting out from 44AD, plus the next 5 years, what do you need to do? So in all 6 years, current year plus the next 5 years, in all 6 years, what do you need to do? Maintain the books of accounts and get it audited. Maintain the books of accounts and get it audited is what is the requirement, students, that needs to be taken into account. So this, can you see this particular part, students, the diagram which I have made? AY 1718, 44AD he has taken. AY 1819, 44AD also has to be taken. AY 1920, he has taken 44AD, and the current AY of your attempt, 44AD, he wants to opt out. The current AY for your attempt, 44AD, wants to opt out. So it is not only 40 for AY 2021, plus the next 5 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So in all, total six AYs in all. What will be the consequence? Maintain the books and get it audited. Maintain the books and get it audited. So what he is going to require? He is required to keep and maintain the books of accounts, and he's also get it audited under section 44AB. Did you all got this one, students? This is an important particular provision that you should always keep this in mind. Fine. Now, apart from that, how you are supposed to determine last particular point, students, one more question that can be there in your examination in respect of this, which is, what is the presumptive income under 44AD? What is the presumptive income under 44AD? So in this regard, to calculate the presumptive income under 44AD, again, I am repeating this point, students, you will always keep in mind for your AY, it is 30th of November, the due date of filing of the ROI, okay? So they will try to give you certain dates also for your attempt. So you have to be a bit careful about the dates which they will give it to you for your attempt. So considering this fact, let's take across this one. So for previous year, 1920 previous year turnover was say 1.5 crores. Now, amount realized up to 30th November 2020 and amount realized through banking channel, through banking channel, and here in cash 50 lakhs, 50 lakhs, 50 lakhs for 44 AD. Presumptive income will be, get me the amount. Yes, sir, Nishank, for your attempt, 30th November. Say it quickly, friends. No, I Swara want the final answer. DSP. What will be the final answer in this case? The presumptive income, I'm talking about it. What should be the presumptive income? 4480 final answer. So presumptive income, students, here it would be very careful about this one. These are the kind of questions. Sandeep, Nishank, so in this context 8% of rupees 50 lakhs plus 6%. So 8% of 50 lakhs, oh sorry, 8% of 1 crore and 6% of 50 lakhs. This is what will be your income. So this is your 8 lakhs. And this is your 3 lakhs, which is 11 lakhs. How come 8% of 1 crore? What is the reason behind this 8% of 1 crore? Because, students, only the amount that you have realized, see, the law is like this, only the amount that you have realized on or before the due date of filing of the ROI please pay attention to this one. Only the amount that you have realized through banking channel on or before the due date of filing of the ROI. And as I told you, your due date for your attempt happens to be 30th of November. Next year, the due date has changed because of COVID factor, due dates are different. So in that regard, you the presumptive rate, the presumptive rate students of 6% of that turnover, which is realized through banking channel on or before the due date of filing of the ROI, that is what will be the presumptive income. And for the balance turnover comes to 50 lakhs for the cash and the 50 lakhs which is recovered after the due date of 139.1. So on the balance turnover, you will apply 8%. On the balance turnover, you will apply the 8%, and that exactly how the things would be considered. So this is how the things are there, students, in this regard. So students, I hope that all of you have got hold with this particular point. Did you all got hold with this one? Sonu? All of you through with this one? Students, shall we then proceed further? If you're all through, then let's move further, students, herein. So please be careful. You will make a simple mistake on this one. Don't make the mistake in the examination. You just be very, very careful about the way it has to be considered. Fine. Now we have done with this particular part. Now I have also have told you, students, for tax audit, students, only this much will be sufficient. This much. Five clause. Just remember this five clause. So only whatever I have marked, just stick with that. Synopsis and applicability, you may skip it right now. You can just focus on whatever we have discussed. Presumptive income, students, this up till this one, whatever I have marked. So you can just forget this notes segment and all the stuff. Okay. Now this advanced tax, students, is very important. This is again an important MCQ based question that can be targeted to you in the examination on the advanced tax basis. Now students, the person who, because you have 234 ABC, isn't it? So we all know, friends, there's an advanced tax topic which is there in your IPCC, wherein we have got a quarterly due dates. There are quarterly due dates for the payment of the advanced tax. But those who are opting for the presumptive mode of taxation, which is 44AD, 44ADA and all. So for them, the advanced tax, students, for them, there is whatever is the advanced tax that they have to pay, they don't have to pay quarterly. They have to pay by 15th of March. So there is only one due date for them, for the purpose of payment of the advance tax. Unlike in the case of other normal SSE, unlike in the case of the other normal SSE for whom there is a quarterly due date by which they have to pay the advance tax, failure of which will invite interest at the rate of 1% per month or part thereof from that due date which happens quarterly, from that due date which happens quarterly, as far as the 44AD or 44ADA presumptive provision SSEs are concerned. For them, there is only one due date, and that is 15th of March. And therefore, if at all there is a delay, if I am subject to a presumptive provision of 44AD and I don't pay the advance tax on 15th of March, so there is one section, students, 234C, there is one section of interest charge, and that 234C is for the delay that has taken place during that particular previous year itself. During that previous year itself. So which previous year we are talking about it? We are talking about the previous year 1920. So in this previous year, what is the delay that has happened from your side of not paying the advance tax? So I can say the delay for this previous year is 15 days when I am opting for 44ADA provision. So delay from my side is how much? 15 days, 15. And if 15 days is what is the delay, how come 15 days from 16th of March to 31st of March? I should have paid by 15th of March. I should have paid by 15th of March. So therefore, the delay from my side is from 16th of March to 31st of March. It means 15 days, half month. And therefore, just now I told you, if there is a delay for a month or even a part thereof, for a month or even a part thereof, the interest would be charged at the rate of 1%. The interest will be charged, students, at the rate of 1%. So therefore, students, in this regard, 1% is what they are doing it in this context, and that is how the things has to be looked upon. I hope that you have got hold with this particular provision in this case. Did you all got this one? All of you? Fine. So this is how the things are there. So I hope that all of you have, just be very careful. So 234C, this part could be also an important one for some objective MCQ kind of a thing. So he has got only one due date. This is 15th of March. And if he fails to pay the advance, he shall be liable to pay interest as per section 234C. And what is the interest? So interest would be 1% for 1 month. So 1% under 234C that he is supposed to pay. Okay, this part, friends, you can ignore for your examination, not now, for the last days and all. So that was what would be there. So this is one thing which I have discussed just now with all of you. And what was that? 8% and 6%. This is what I was discussing. The existing rate of 8% under 44AD of the act has been reduced to 6% in respect of the amount of the total turnover received through banking channel during the previous year or before the due date of filing of the ROI. That is what I have told you. On or before the due date of filing of the ROI under section 139(1), which for your attempt it is 30th of November. Therefore, before that due date, whatever is the amount that you have realized through banking channel on that turnover, on that realized turnover, you will be subject to 6% rate, and in respect of all the remaining turnover of that previous year, you will be subject to 8% rate. With that one, students, now 44ADA is very simple. Herein, for the presumptive income for the eligible profession, so eligible profession, students. But before that, there is one 44AE. So what is it for profession, students? Just now we have discussed for profession as well. Just now we have discussed for the profession as well. And the limit, students, here is 1 crore. The limit over here, students, is 50 lakhs. The limit over here is, students, 50 lakhs. Applicable to a resident, individual, but only the specified profession. You will say, sir, who is a specified profession? So, students, specified profession are those which is covered in 44A, 44AA, which is in the previous slide. And I have given a mnemonics, aim at CA life. How do you remember this particular thing? Aim at CA life. You will say, what is this aim at CA life? So, we will go to the previous slide later on, and I will tell you these are the specified profession which I have made you remember through mnemonics. Okay. Now, if those specific in which your CA is also there. So, say for example, if you are a CA and then when you practice, your turnover is not exceeding 50 lakhs, then students, you have a choice. Choice of offering 50% of that turnover which do not exceed 50 lakhs. 50% of that turnover will be deemed to be your PGBP. Will be deemed to be your PGBP. Some students will say, sir, this is very injustice. For business, it is only 8% and 6%. And for a profession, it is 50%. You can just imagine, if you are in a profession, the expenditure, the corresponding expenditure is also very less. Just imagine a CA providing what kind of stipend to the article. So therefore, you can just imagine that having a 50% margin is a reasonable margin that can be expected at least from the specified profession which they have highlighted upon. And that is the reason why they say 50% of the turnover. Now, if you will say, no, 50% is still very high. My turnover is 40 lakhs. And then you are taking 50% means you are assuming my income is 20 lakhs. Whereas my income is, say, 12 lakhs only. Which implies that you want to declare your income below the limit of section 44ADA. So, if you want to declare your income which is below the limit of section 44ADA, you are welcome to declare it. But again, the same requirement, students, and the requirement is maintain the books and get it audited. Maintain the books and get it audited. We have also seen in the tax audit 44ADA, the point number 4, D point. If you are for 44ADA, when you want to declare the income which is below 50% of the turnover, then you need to maintain the books and get it audited. So that is what would be for 44DA students in this context. So this is also quite simple particular point. This interlinking part, students, you can just ignore now all this thing, because this particular thing I'm not touching upon with all of you. So you can just simply ignore this interlinking and all these things, at least now at this stage. Now 44A, students, is equally very important, and this is applicable special provision for computing profit and gains for this GTA. In the goods carriage, students, not the passenger carriage. Be careful on that one. It is for the goods carriage. Now, applicable to whom? It is to applicable to any person who is not owning more than 10 goods carriage at any time during the previous year. Not owning 10 goods carriage at any time during the previous year. Students, you can expect a very intelligent way of framing the question, which we have got in our question for practice, which we'll do in this question for practice. But just remember that this particular SSC, this SSC can be any person, but should not own more than 10 vehicles, which is the goods carriage, at any point during the previous year. Okay, now that person will be eligible to then offer the business income on a presumptive basis under section 44A. That person will then be eligible to offer the business income on a presumptive basis under section 44A. Now you will say, how we are going to offer the income on a presumptive basis under section 44A? This is what we can do. It estimated income, the estimated income for the heavy goods vehicle more than 12 MT gross vehicle weight, the income will be deemed to be an amount equal to what? 1000 per ton of gross vehicle weight or unladen weight. So heavy goods vehicle, it is as simple as that, students. Visualize heavy goods vehicle, the trucks, okay, versus a small tempos. We see small tempos also, which is also a good carriage vehicle. Within the city, these small tempos run and distribute those particular goods within the city. In the highways, the goods carriage vehicles are the big trucks and all. So their weight is more than 12 metric tons. So these, if I am the owner of 8 such truck, you are the owner of these small tempos. You do the transportation within the city. I do the interstate transportation. Then in that case, both of us are having 8. But whether in both of our cases, whether the presumptive income, will it be same? And the answer is no. I should tell you, students, up till one point of time, very recently, it was same for both of us. I, who own that 8 trucks heavy goods vehicle, and you, who owns light goods vehicle. For both of us, the presumptive income was same. They were only focusing on the numbers. Now they realize that the freight which I earn is much higher as compared to freight that you earn. So therefore, they have now sought to distinguish the presumptive rate that is applicable on me versus the presumptive rate that would be applicable on you. So see what is the situation. Or maybe, students, I can be only one person and I am having 3 heavy goods vehicle, 3 trucks and then 2 light commercial vehicles. So 3 trucks and 2 light commercial vehicles. 3 plus 2. So that is also a combination which is possible, isn't it? So in such case, how the income will be considered? So students, for a heavy goods vehicle, what they have suggested is 1000 per ton of the gross vehicle weight or unladen weight. 1000 per ton, students, of the gross vehicle weight or unladen weight, as the case may be, per month. That is also equally important, students. Per month or part of the month, if I have owned for a part of the month, like I have purchased, say on 15th of February, then I'll take for 2 months. 2 months into say that the vehicle weight is say 20 metric tons. So 1000 tons for 1000 rupees for every ton per month. So 20 tons will give us 20,000 rupees. 20,000 rupees which will be 20,000 rupees which will be for 1 month. Here I have got 2 months, because part of the month has to be considered as one full month. So in all, my income will become 20,000 into 2, which is 40,000. So this is how the income has to be computed. Now this is for this. What about the light commercial vehicle? The light commercial vehicle, students, for the light commercial vehicle herein, okay, this has gone down. You can just here write, students, please write after this. Other than HGV means heavy goods vehicle, the income फोर एलजीवी, एलजीवी इज लाइट गुड्स व्हीकल, शैल बी रुपीज 7,500 पर मंथ और पार्ट देयर ऑफ फॉर ईच सच एलजीवी, फॉर ईच सच एलजीवी। सो अदर देन एचजीवी द इनकम फॉर एलजीवी दैट इज लाइट गुड्स व्हीकल शैल बी रुपीज 7,500 पर मंथ और पार्ट देयर ऑफ फॉर ईच सच एलजीवी, फॉर ईच सच लाइट गुड्स व्हीकल। Okay, students. Now, in this regard, we have dealt with this one. Same provision, students. If supposedly I want to offer the income which is below this limit, then what I'm supposed to do? Same two things. What are those two things? Maintain the books and get it audited. If I have to show an income which is below this threshold limit, then I need to maintain the books and get it audited. These are the two things which always will remain constant in any of the presumptive provisions that you all are going to do. Fine, students. Now let's look upon to this question which is I've given to you over here. So this, as I told you, this is actually an important section, students. Outrightly these things can be targeted. So there are two questions which we will quickly run through it. Question number one. Mr. X commenced the business of operating goods vehicle on 1st of April 2019. He purchased the following vehicles during the previous year 2019-2020. Compute his income under section 44A for AY 2021. So how do you go about it? Gross vehicle weight in the kilograms and number is 2. Date of purchase, students, is this date. Okay. Now 6,500, 15th of March 2020. So 15 days only. During the previous year, it is only for 15 days. So if it is only for 15 days, part of the month will be taken as 1 month. 10,000 kilograms, number is 3 and 16th of July, so still 10,000 we don't have to worry, it will be considered as light commercial vehicle, light goods vehicle. 11,000 still on lower side, light goods vehicle. 15,000 and 15,000, 5 and 6 is where you go to the heavy goods vehicle, and 1,000 rupees will be taken for every ton, so 15 tons will fetch us 15,000 rupees. Okay, so in that regard, so two already are given to you, but here number are two and two. By the way, what is the count? So here it is 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, and 10. So the number hasn't increased, the number hasn't increased by 10. You should not own more than, it can be equal to, but it should not go more than, students, 10 in the entire previous year, in the entire previous year. So yes, congratulations, it hasn't gone beyond 10. So as I told you, up till this, it's quite simple here. So this would be for 12 months, you'll take 12 months here, you'll take 1 month here, you'll take also entire July, so 9 months. Here you will take January, February and March, 3 months. Okay, so therefore into what? Into this thing. Here you will take how many months? You will start with August. So August, 8 months. Thereafter here, February, March, 2 months. So this is the number of months calculation, students. Part of the month you will go wrong. So you have to be careful about the part of the month calculation. And on that note, students, so Mr. X does not own. Okay, what would your answer change if the goods vehicle purchased in April 19 were put to use in July 19 in this context? So whether the put to use, students, herein, will it be having an impact? And this impact is only for depreciation calculation, not for this one. So using is not required. What is important in this regard, students, is that the ownership, that's it. When it has started from using, that is not a criteria. So students, first the heavy goods vehicle calculation, they have done it first, they have done for heavy goods calculation. So as I told you, 8 months, and 2 months. And now they have multiplied by number of vehicle, so 8 into 2, number of vehicle 16, and 2 into 1, 2. So this is the number of month calculation that they have done. And then for light vehicle students, 12 months, 1 month, 9 and 3, the way we have done it above, they have also got it the same. And they have multiplied it and they got the answer. Fine students, so this is how they have dealt with it. So you have to be very, very careful in this context. Honey, the charts are already there in my Telegram channel. My Telegram channel, you can go there and you can already find the revision videos also as well as the chart. And if you are through with this one, let's take question number 2. Mr. Praveen engaged in the retail trade reports a turnover of rupees 1,98,50,000 students. Quite a huge turnover. But it is not exceeding rupees 2 crores. It is not exceeding rupees 2 crores for the financial year 1920. His income from the said business as per the books of accounts is rupees 13,20,000. Okay. And by the way, 8% if I do 8% of 2 crores also, if I do 8% of 2 crores, then it becomes 16 lakhs. It becomes 16 lakhs, roughly around 16 lakhs. So this income, if I take 8% of 1 crore 98 lakhs, roughly it comes to around 16 lakhs. Whereas if from his books of accounts, he is saying that his income is only 13,20,000, which is computed as per the head PGBP. Retail trade is the only source of income of Mr. Praveen for assessment year 1920. It was the first year for which he declared. Last year was his first year in which he declared the income as per the presumptive basis. So this AY 2021, would be the second year. Okay. Point number 1. Is Mr. Praveen also eligible to opt for presumptive determination of his income chargeable to tax for AY 2021? Why not? His turnover has not exceeded rupees 2 crores. Further, he is into the eligible business. He is not claiming the profit link deduction. Going by all these factors, it is very clear that yes, he is eligible for 44AD deduction, which he can offer under the head PGBP. Point number 2, question number 2. If so, determine his income from retail trade as per the applicable presumptive income. It's very simple, as I told you. You take 8% of 1,98,50,000, which they have calculated as 15,88,000. I told very near to 16 lakhs. Point number 3. What is the due date for filing his ROI? And now, so due date, as I told you, has changed. So just for all of your attempt, 30th November 2020. Just every due date has gone to 30th November 2020. All the due date. Your due date is 30th November 2020. As simple as that. Fine students. So this is how it has to be considered in this regard. So the calculation which has been made over here. So I hope that you have got hold with this point. Now the one section which is there, students, this is 44AA, maintenance of the books of accounts. 44AA, maintenance of the books of accounts, students. Now if you see on the maintenance of the books of accounts, I have made this mnemonics, students. I have made this mnemonics, aim at CA life. Remember that, aim at CA life, which I was just telling. You don't have to by heart it, but at least remember this, aim at CA life. And A is the agent, I is the IT guy, M is the medical guy, A is the architectural, T is the technical, CA, company secretary and accountancy, L is legal, I is interior decorator, F is the film artist, and E is the engineering. So aim at CA life. Okay, so that is the specified professional. Now if you see on the left hand side, there is a specified professional, and on the right hand side there is a non-specified profession. So non-specified profession other than this and business. So, and this business is all the business. For all the business, this category, this compartment, and for specified profession only the left hand side compartment. Now if you see students here, there's one important point which you should always keep in mind. One important point that you should keep in mind, and that is about this. For them student, the gross receipt should be more than 1.5 lakh. Gross receipt turnover. And that should be for all the 3 years immediately preceding the previous year. All the 3 years immediately preceding the previous year. Now, students, first of all, they have got only the gross receipt as the criteria. Only gross, and it should be that the threshold, and it should exceed. It should exceed the threshold. 1.5 lakhs in all the 3 years, students. This is important. In all the 3 years, it should exceed in all the 3 years. This is I'm talking about the specified profession. For the specified profession, it should exceed for all the 3 years. But if you see on the right hand side, on the right hand side, students, there is an individual HUF and then there is another SSE. Now, if you see, they have got two criteria. Here it was only the gross receipt as a criteria, whereas here, if you see, they have got two criteria. And what is the two criteria? One is a criteria of income and another is a criteria of turnover, which is gross receipt. So any one of the criteria they should fulfill, and this criteria should be in any one of the immediately preceding three previous years. So whereas in the case of the specified profession, there was only one criteria of gross receipt, and that criteria should exceed the threshold of rupees 1.5 lakhs in all the three preceding previous year, only then there would be a mandatory requirement to maintain the books. As compared to this, for all the other profession and for the business, for all the other profession and for the business, there are two criteria, and the two criteria are, one is the income based criteria, another is a gross turnover based criteria. Any one of the two criteria has to be satisfied, which implies that the income or the turnover should exceed the threshold. Should exceed the threshold. What is the threshold? 2.5 lakhs and 25 lakhs, like that. For the, I'm talking only for individual. You only remember, you'll say, sir, I have to remember for all. No, remember only for this individual. So, and 2.5 lakhs income criteria or 25 lakhs the turnover criteria. Only if either of the two criteria you have to see. Either the income criteria exceed in one of the last 3 years, or the turnover criteria exceed in one of the last 3 years. If anything gets satisfied, students, you will say that maintaining the books of accounts would be compulsory. Maintaining the books of accounts would be compulsory. Apart from that, students, we also know that where the SSE who is opting out of the presumptive income, apart from this, you also know where the SSE is opting out of the presumptive income. Then on such opt out of the presumptive income, he will have to maintain the books and get it audited. Maintain the books and get it audited. I hope that this point is well taken by all of you, because this is where you may go wrong in this particular context. Fine, students, this is how you may go wrong in this particular context. So again, I'm repeating this point, students, for all the other profession, the criteria is either the income criteria or the turnover criteria. And this criteria should, one of the two criteria, not both, one of the two criteria should get satisfied in, should exceed the threshold of the monetary limit. If it is income, the monetary limit is 2.5 lakhs. If it is the turnover, the monetary limit is 2 and 25 lakhs. So one of these two criteria should exceed the threshold in any one of the last 3 years. In any one in the last 3 years. And if it exceed in anyone in the last 3 years, then in that case, what we are going to say? We are going to say that this particular provision would be applicable in this regard. So this provision would be applicable in this particular context. Did you all got this one, students? Fine. So this is how. So the books of accounts would be required to be maintained. Apart from the other two which I've told you. That if you want to opt out from the presumptive taxation, if you want to opt out from the presumptive taxation, even in that particular case, there is a mandatory aspect of Maintaining the books and getting it audited. Maintaining the books and getting it audited. So hopefully students, now this is all done completely, and I have also told you about what? About the approach. Students, my suggestion would be do herein 32, 35, 35 AD, 44 AD, 44 double A, 44 AB. Please write the section, some important section for your revision purpose. Quickly. Quickly write important section for a revision, constant revision. I'm writing it over here. 32, 35, and 35 AD in one stroke. So one compartment is this for revision. Another compartment, 43 B and 40 AI. What is 40 AI? The disallowance. Remember, 40 AI and 40 IA. I have given you the chart. So the chart which I have prepared for all of you. Remember in the last lecture, in fact, we were doing this only. So 43B and 40 AI and IA. And the third one, students, is about 44 AD. 44 ADA. Today, whatever you have done. 44 AE. 44 double A and 44 AB. I'm giving you the three compartment. Keep revising this, your tension of PGP is over. Keep revising this and your tension of PGPP is over. You will say that, sir, how do we revise it? How do we revise this one? Go in the reverse order. Go in the reverse order. You have just not done 44 AD, 44 ADA, 44 AE, 44 AA, 44 AB. So go in the reverse order. Then 43 B and all that you have done. And then 32, attack the way I have taught you through the chart. Attack it the way I have taught you through the chart. The way we have gone with analyzing each and everything, 35 and 35 AD, that exactly how you're going to do it. So revise it in this way, students, and your entire headache of the most biggest topic of the head PGP is over. I have already taught you about the residential status, scope of the total income chargeable to tax under the act, and the exemption. So these are the topic that we have already have done it in our initial session. With that, now with this topic also done, if the CG is done, which I'm going to get it done fast, if CG is also done, students, then I think we are done with our substantial load, and then only small areas are there we can just try to speak about on them. This is a substantial topic, CG, as far as your syllables is concerned. So I'll start tomorrow, and tomorrow I'll try to focus on this particular part. I have already given you the contact number for the WhatsApp group, so you can join in that WhatsApp group. Tomorrow you will message it, and accordingly the person will make the WhatsApp group. Okay, so see you then, students, tomorrow then, same time, 9 o'clock at night. Fine, a good night batch is what we are doing it in this case. See you then tomorrow. 4CFL and honey, I have in my Telegram channel. If you go, I've already have put across a lot of PDF charts and also charts on non-resident taxation and transfer pricing. If you go in my Telegram channel, you'll get it, you'll come to know there. CA Durgesh Singh is my Telegram channel. Go there and you will get hold with that particular part. Okay, please go there and you will find it. The charts I've already have kept it along with the notes. Fine. Good night to you, students. Take care, and please revise the way I have taught you now. And I think you have a firm grip over the events. See you then. Good night.